Good afternoon, dear Lynn. For me, it's a great honor and to present you before this distinguished audience. As you all are aware, Mr. Lyndon LaRouche is a great statesman, and he is the founding contributing editor of our magazine, Executive Intelligence Review. In addition to that, Mr. LaRouche is a Democratic Party pre-candidate for the presidency of the United States for the year 2004. I would like to thank you, Lynn, for granting us this time, because we know that your views and your advice at this moment is now more than ever needed and solicited from all parts of the world, so we know how valuable your time is. Before presenting you to the auditorium, I would like to simply recall a few words of what Friedrich Schiller said, which is that there are great moments in history which sometimes find a people that are too small for those moments. I believe that the terrible moments we are facing today present us with a very palpable reality, and that is that our governments, the people who govern us, both here and there and with very few exceptions, truly are showing a smallness before the circumstances that we are facing. Regardless, your presence here at this moment makes this historical moment, this current moment, a very different one. You warned us going back to 1994 and even earlier. You advised the world that not only was this crisis, this economic crisis that we are facing, that this was not simply yet another cyclical crisis, but rather it was a systemic crisis. But you not only warned us about the crisis, you also made proposals, various programmatic alternatives and solutions to the crisis. For example, your proposal for a new Bretton Woods. You, along with your wife Helga and your organization, your international organization, we have persisted along with you in this effort to clarify the characteristics of this crisis and the alternatives which you have presented along with us to solve the problems the world is facing today. However, you also warned the world, and this was reiterated most recently in a speech which you gave in New York, excuse me, in a Washington and New York auditorium in July of this past year, that we were facing an imminent war in the Middle East. You warned us at the time that there were certain international oligarchical financial interests, one worldist interests, that were promoting the perverse theory of a crisis of a shock of civilization, a conflict of civilizations, as a way of avoiding or taking control of the financial debacle. We are now facing, unfortunately, that all of your warnings have come true. That is to say, the facts have confronted us with the reality of today. And I think even the most obtuse at this point will have to recognize at this point that not only were you right, but that we have to pay very close attention to what you are saying as to how to face this crisis. So, Lynn, once again, I would like to thank you for your time and leave you with an auditorium paying close attention to what your words are today. So, ladies and gentlemen, please welcome Lyndon LaRouche from the United States.
There are several things we should go through in series. First of all, the crisis. We're in the final breakdown phase of the existing world monetary and financial system. Not one part of it, but essentially all of it. That means the Americas, it means Europe, it means most of Eurasia, it means the world. Nothing can be done to save this system in its present form. It will go into a phase of disintegration during the present and the next quarter, before the beginning of the year. It may limp along in some form after the first of the year, but the system is essentially finished and cannot be preserved in its present form with its present institutions. This is also because of this crisis. It's also a very dangerous period in history in other respects. We have now the threat of generally spreading warfare throughout the world. particularly since the September 11th terrorist attacks in the United States, which are largely an internal operation, but obviously may have involved elements from other parts of the world as participants in the operation. We have not seen the end of it. No one has stopped the terrorists. No one has identified yet the terrorists, the actual ones. So they're sitting there ready to strike again. Now, this is not unusual in history for times of great financial and economic crisis. For example, 1932, 1933, we had a world crisis which at that point centered on Germany, because Germany was a pivot strategically of the effects of the crisis. At that point, you had in Germany an effort to stop Hitler from inside Germany. This effort was led by a chancellor of Germany, von Schleicher, Kurt von Schleicher. At that point, certain bankers in London, headed by the former Bank of England head, Montague Norman, and by groups in New York City, including the Harriman interest, including the grandfather of the present president of the United States, Prescott Bush. These people with Norman, with people like Schacht in Germany, with the von Schroeder banking interests, with von Papen, conspired to overthrow the von Schleicher government, which was done on the 28th of January, 1932. On the 30th of January, at the instigation of U.S. bankers, Norman and Schacht, Hitler was put into power in Germany as a chancellor. His power was not complete at that point. A month later, the Reichstag, the parliament of Germany, was burned down in what would be called a terrorist incident. Immediately, the Nazi Party took measures to declare emergency laws, and then to the parliament enacted new laws extending the emergency. Less than a month later, Hjalmar Schacht became head of the Reichsbank and became the controller of the arms drive of Germany leading toward World War II, which was already planned. We're in such a time of crisis now, danger, coup d'etats, overthrows of governments, revolutions, violence, terrorism, are the characteristic of a period in which a financial system collapses. Because it's a time of desperate men. You have men who have dominated the world with the present financial system. That system is now doomed. They're desperate. They're blind to reality. And they're determined to hold on to their power by any means possible at this time. They don't care about the future. They care about what they consider their way of life, their power, their commanding position in world affairs. So therefore, there's a struggle between some of these financial interests who refuse to face reality because they don't wish to, and the interests of sovereign nation states and peoples. It's a dangerous period. My concern is to do several things. First of all, to try to bring together forces which, as political forces, internationally, including governments and others, will bring this danger to an end. Secondly, we must have a reform of the international financial and monetary system immediately. This means bankruptcy reorganization. Now, most of you probably are familiar with the procedures for bankruptcy organization applying to corporations, to large firms. But the bankruptcy of a government, and we're going to have many bankrupt governments around the world in the coming period, in South America and elsewhere, is inevitable. It can't be prevented. The debts are beyond any possible means of paying the debts. Therefore, a state of bankruptcy will exist. But this is bigger than a bankruptcy of government. This is the bankruptcy of a world system, a world financial system, the IMF system. And therefore, you must have a concert of power, of political power, which has the authority to put an entire international monetary and financial system into bankruptcy reorganization. The principles are not much different than they are for the bankruptcy of an important firm in a nation. There are certain firms you do not want to have collapse at any cost because they're too important to the country. And therefore, somehow you will arrange that these firms will continue to function because they perform an essential function for the nation. When you're dealing with the bankruptcy of a nation, the, the authority of this principle is even stronger. You cannot bankrupt a nation. You cannot foreclose on a nation. That would be mass murder. You must keep the essential institutions of the nation functioning. You must keep the levels of employment high. You must keep all essential institutions functioning. You must have a program for recovery. When you have an international crisis of this type, an international financial and monetary system, you have a similar situation. You cannot liquidate countries. You cannot decide which country is going to survive or not. All nations must survive, and they must survive together. But most of the debts will never be paid. And really, they shouldn't be paid, because most of the debt was not earned honestly. With the system established in 1971, with the collapse of the old Bretton Woods system, the debts of many parts of the world, as in Ibero-America, for example, the nations of Central and South America have paid more on the debt they owed as of 1971, far more than they owed. And they have far greater debts today than those they owed at the beginning. Much of this debt was absolutely fraudulent. In an attempt to maintain the system, vast amounts of credit have been poured into things that should not have been subsidized. And this now is debt. We have the international derivative speculation, more debt. We have hundreds of trillions of dollars of above board and below and secret or hidden debt around the world, which can never be paid at the present level of about $42 trillion equivalent of total world product. You can't pay the debt out of that amount of total product. And the amount of total product produced is collapsing. In the United States, we have collapse, collapse, collapse every day. New firms are cutting back 10%, 20%, 30% of their employment. It goes on and on. In Europe, it's the same. Around much of the world, it's the same. So the means to pay this debt does not exist. So we will have to put the entire financial system into bankruptcy or reorganization, cancel whole categories of debt, freeze other kinds of debt, that is, suspend any interest accrual and so forth on this debt. But nonetheless, keep banks open because they're essential, keep governments functioning, keep pensions paid, keep the economy moving. That we can do. We did something similar in the United States in 1933 under Franklin Roosevelt and beyond. That's a precedent. We know how to use that precedent for today. We formed at the end of World War II a monetary system, the Bretton Woods system, which worked in the parts of the world for which it was working. It worked. Not perfectly, but it succeeded. The world under the IMF system that was part of it grew. The incomes of people grew. The economy grew. Conditions became better, despite all the things that were wrong. It worked. We can go back to that kind of thinking, starting from scratch with a new monetary system and a new financial system, and we can live. But we need something else. We need a growth program. The system made a lot of mistakes. The system is now bankrupt. In fact, most bankruptcies, somebody, the management, made a mistake. So you reorganize the management, bring in competent management, and use as a model things that did work as a way to start the economy of the firm or the country going. What are these projects? Well, first of all, we must create large amounts of public credit in most parts of the world, which will have the effect of increasing employment. That is, the state would use the authority of the sovereign nation state to create sovereign state credit, which will then be used to create employment in essential areas of employment that can be organized. This will be, to a large degree, infrastructure. It will be as much as possible reviving industries that have been closed or partly closed, which should be reopened. Because we cannot collapse the level of production of wealth in countries. We must do precisely the opposite. We must increase the production of wealth in every possible way. We must manage it, of course, but we must increase employment and production. Fiscal austerity methods are suicide. They're murder. Fiscal austerity as a method must be canceled. No more bleeding economies to try to roll over debts. It won't work. You'll destroy civilization if you try. But we need special projects which will do this. Now we have one class of project which is immediately available to all governments. It's called basic economic infrastructure. There are always water systems, transportation systems, sanitation systems, healthcare facilities, and so forth. These things are always needed. Governments have well-defined projects, every government does, of things that need to be done that should be done, including the increase of production of power. In Peru, for example, you have water potential of development of water resources, which is crucial for the country, for its future. These things can be done immediately, as we used to do it in the United States with the military civil corps of engineers, to launch large-scale projects conducted by engineering groups, sometimes as military employees, sometimes as civilians working with military groups and so forth. We built large-scale infrastructure. By building the large-scale infrastructure, we put people to work, useful work. These people were paid. They bought goods for their families. Communities prospered as a result of the infrastructure works. Subcontractors would obtain contracts to assist and participate in large-scale infrastructure, and the economies would grow. But we also need something more. We need two other things. First of all, we need the obvious. We have in Eurasia today a program which I've called a Eurasian land bridge, and my associates and I call this. It is now, in a sense, being adopted or in the process of being adopted in Eurasia. That is, Russia, China, other countries are coming together in cooperation around large-scale development projects, including transportation projects. Modern types of rail transport, including in China, magnetic levitation rail systems, are now being introduced. The idea is to create from the Atlantic to the Pacific a system of communication and development which enables us to take the areas of Central Asia, which are wealthy in terms of natural resources, but poor in development. And by introducing development across this area and transportation, we can make this an area of growth. And this would mean that countries such as Japan or Western Europe, and countries which normally were producing high technology capital goods, will find in this arrangement a market for increasing flows of production of goods into countries like those of Central, South, and East Asia. China, for example, is a great market if the proper kinds of assistance are given to it. A great internal development. This area contains the largest population of the world, part of the world's population. So this is a great opportunity. If, as is also being proposed, if from Eurasia, not only do the Americas participate in the market in Eurasia, not only if Americans participate in the market which will also develop in Africa for development, but there will be the building of a bridge, a tunneled bridge from Siberia to Alaska. That bridge will come down through the Americas, through Central America, into South America, all the way to Tierra del Fuego, Cape Horn, to unify the Eurasia in that way and in other ways with the Americas. We have in South America, in particular, we have large areas which are undeveloped, lack of infrastructure to develop them, with vast resources. Patagonia, for example, vast resources. Other parts of South America, vast resources, undeveloped. We have to convert the opportunity of development of these areas with their resources, to convert that into a great market for investment. Now we need to do something else. We need to have some science driver programs for the world as a whole. We need to set some objectives in terms of scientific objectives. new technologies, breakthroughs, new forms of energy, higher density forms of energy. These kinds of things we must have. We must use our universities and develop our universities to produce the cadres for these projects, to produce the skilled people to implement them, to do the scientific research which will feed these kinds of scientific projects. And in that way, we can create a new kind of national economy. Not really new, but a qualitative improvement. If you look at the history of mankind, especially modern European civilization, the history of mankind is based on something in which where man differs absolutely from all animal forms of life. Man is the only creature which can discover a universal physical principle, can replicate that discovery in the minds of other people, can cooperate to use those principles to increase man's power over nature. Through this means, man is able to increase the productive powers of labor, to improve the demographic characteristics of population, to increase the potential size of populations that can be supported, raise the standard of living, and conquer areas which could not have been conquered beforehand. Why don't we just take that lesson, especially of modern society, and use that to reform our economies? That is, mobilize our universities and educational systems as science driver institutions, where old discoveries are reenacted for the students, where research is done on new principles, where the research work on new principles is done together with engineering programs to test new principles, to convert them into new technologies which can be used, to connect our economies, the productive sector of the economy, with these university centers in order to create an economy in which we are increasing the percentage of the labor force which is employed in fundamental research and in engineering, in creating new technologies. To increase the percentage of the population employed in industries which are of high technology operatives, who are able to assimilate an outpouring of new advanced technologies to make them real and to bring them into general practice. So these, I think, are the things which we should do at this time. These are the things which can lead us out of the world mess. What we need is essentially the political will to understand that this has to be done, to bring nations together and other forces to say, we are going to put the system into financial reorganization, into bankruptcy reorganization. We're going to generate masses of public credit by governments and by cooperation among governments to expand employment, especially productive employment, on a world scale in each country. We're going to take other measures to promote the expansion of employment in useful forms of production. We're going to maintain social stability in the general welfare. Now we're going to reach out beyond that to pioneer in great infrastructure projects, which will be transcontinental in their significance, to unite the continents, to unify the human race in cooperation. We must mobilize our population around the theme of education, of scientific education, to elevate the meaning of nation state to sovereign states which are concentrating on developing their populations through education to become science driver economies, to upgrade the quality of work for which people are employed, and to create a kind of world which we've been trying to build ever since about the 15th century in Europe with the great Renaissance there. I think that we have to say we've come to a time where humanity faces the greatest danger that the human race has ever faced in all known history to date, right now. We're in a period where if we don't do something to correct the problems, we could go into a new dark age of all civilization. We're vulnerable now. We don't have the resources we used to have to live through a depression. The rate of death, which will result from a continuation of this collapse with no solution, would amount to a new dark age for humanity. But looking at the danger of great wars, a new dark age, and great convulsions and chaos, perhaps this will alert us to the fact that we cannot behave as children anymore. We have to become adults. We cannot think about our convenience, our personal interest in a narrow way or a silly way. We've got to think about what are we doing about a future humanity, our children, our grandchildren, who are threatened by this great crisis. We're becoming older. In the course of time, we'll die. What are we going to leave to those who come after us? Are we going to leave a dark age, or are we going to be the giants who created the opportunity for not only a revival and preservation of civilization, but who in our time did something of which we can be proud in the eyes of our deceased ancestors, something of which we can be proud in the eyes of those who come after us? We must use the great crisis and the fear it strikes in many people as an incentive to grow up, to grow out of small-mindedness, and to have the imagination to see solutions, and to devote our lives to the purpose of bringing those solutions into being, so that when we die, we will be able to say, we lived, and it was good. Thank you.
Gracias. Thank you very much, Mr. LaRouche, for your presentation. While we prepare the questions, I have here one question that at the beginning, one of the students, an economic student, gave me regarding some statements, recent statements from the economic minister of Peru, Pedro Pablo Kuczynski. The question is the following. Mr. LaRouche, the Minister of Economics of Peru, Pedro Pablo Kuczynski, has just recognized that the world finds itself in a very grave crisis, a cosmic crisis, this whole Kuczynski described it. However, our Minister of Economics has said that the policies of the United States of cutting interest rates will be beneficial for the debtor countries such as ours. We would like to hear your opinion regarding this, Mr. LaRouche.
First of all, one must be realistic, and everyone, I think, in Peru knows this, that there are only three cultures on this planet, national cultures, which at this time of crisis are able to think in terms of global solutions for problems. Now, there are many countries in which leading people could say whether a proposed global solution would be good or not. But they would not propose that their country initiate that solution. The three nations whose national culture permits them to indulge in thinking about making world changes, worldwide changes in institutions, are the United States, Russia, and the British monarchy. Every other part of this world, except now China's a different case, but China doesn't think in global terms. India's an important country, but India does not think in global terms, even though some Indians or some Chinese may. But the national culture does not support the idea of the nation as shaping the planet. The national culture of most countries thinks, as in Peru, of trying to shape events so their country survives and has the opportunity of doing something with its own destiny. But shaping world destiny, no. So therefore, when you hear from a minister of a country, which is not one of these world powers, you have to recognize that the minister will always speak by being realistic, by saying, I'm going to say what will not get me overthrown or shot by a superpower or its agents. The problem is this. To get a solution on a world scale is going to require the cooperation of a number of countries with, hopefully, the United States and Russia. These are the only two countries outside of the British monarchy which are capable of thinking in these terms, thinking of acting. That is, countries that would call other countries together for a great conference to deal for specifically with such things as the breakdown of the present world global monetary and financial system. So, obviously, Mr. Kaczynski, in speaking, and he, of course he has some familiarity with the United States and knows what the temper is of some of the bankers and so forth in the United States, is not going to propose something unsupported, or not likely to, which would not meet approval in New York. That's the problem. It's unfair. It's unjust. I agree it's unjust. It shouldn't be, but that's the way it is. Therefore, my particular job, and the job in a sense of Russia, the job of fairly powerful countries in Europe who will not act on their own, China, which will not really act on its own, Japan will not act on its own, India will not really act on its own on this question. There must be people who come from inside one of the so-called superpowers, which says, or maybe two or more great powers, which say, we want to call a conference to discuss these matters. At that point, then you would find that Germans, Peruvians, French, Italians, and so forth would meet together and say, yes, we want that discussion. In that framework, these kinds of issues could be discussed successfully. My job, coming from the United States and dealing as I have with leaders in Russia and elsewhere around the world, my job, with my knowledge and my recognition around the world, is to introduce a proposal or to sponsor proposals which will actually represent a realistic solution to the actual crisis which faces us. Now, as far as what Mr. Kaczynski is saying, it's wrong. The dropping of the interest rates in the United States is not an act of supremacy or wisdom, it's an act of panic. The head of the Federal Reserve System is panicked. Look, we've had a meeting going on between three figures. The head of the Federal Reserve System, the advisor, economic advisor to President Bush, Lindsay, and the former Secretary of the Treasury, Bob Rubin. This has been going on for a couple of weeks with other people involved, with various institutions visited. No agreement is reached on dealing with what they know to be is the greatest financial crisis that anybody ever imagined. They can't reach agreement. In the meantime, Alan Greenspan, the head of the Federal Reserve System, and people around him are hysterical. They're panic-stricken. They're ready to jump from a skyscraper if they can find one that will take, accept them. And in this mood, they are proposing a dropping of interest rates modeled upon the Japan zero interest rate policy, zero loan policy, a kind of policy which is literally hyperinflationary. You have a situation in which the world is collapsing in physical economic terms. Employment, production are collapsing in Europe. They're collapsing in the United States. It's a catastrophe. It's a depression as bad as 1932-33 already, and getting worse. In the meantime, these idiots are pumping money in, printing money, inventing money, near money, at rates never seen before in history. So you have a rollover of a vast amount of new money coming into an economy which has just lost in the area of the new economy alone in the United States over $3 trillion in a recent period. Asset values wiped out. So this is not a solution, but what is Mr. Kaczynski in Peru going to say? Is he going to say the United States is insane? Well, I'm an American. I can say that. I know it, and I can say it, and I say it. But the policies of New York are insane, and that's why we're getting the kind of situation we are. So as I say, the solution is, the answer is the practical answer. The technical answer is no, it won't work. But the practical answer, the responsive answer is, those of us who are in a position of power, neither because we have power or because we represent a nation which represents power, we have to take responsibility of opening the doors so that people from countries which do not have that power are able to sit at the same table and be heard on their views on these matters to get the kind of discussion we need to get some of these problems settled and solved.
Well, the questions we have so far are very varied. They go from the situation economics, some on the crisis, global crisis, some refer to the Peruvian economy. There are also questions that we have received regarding the national security policy, armed forces. We also have some questions regarding certain specific development projects on the continent, and the also two questions regarding the cultural question. Obviously, there are many. I don't think we can deal with all of them, but I'm going to try to summarize all the questions, although undoubtedly I'm going to try to represent all of them because of taking into account the amount of time Mr. LaRouche has. I believe that we should start with a question that has to do with the global situation.
Dice así, en la en el siglo 21,
in the 21st century, what importance
el aspecto de la seguridad y de la ecología,
what importance do we give to the security and ecology, and how these two aspects, ecology and security, influence international economy and the life of individuals and nations? This question comes from a German journalist, a correspondent from the Frankfurter dot from Alemania, I think, Germany, I think that's how you pronounce the name, I'm not sure.
The Venetian school of ecology, which was started formally by a fellow called Botero in the last part of the 16th century, and continued through the last influential Venetian on the subject, Gian Maria Ortes, the man who wrote the book that was plagiarized by Thomas Malthus. That this Venetian school of ecology is essentially fraudulent, but it has always insisted that populations must be culled in the way we cull cattle herds. When the population becomes excessive and no longer desired by the cattle owner, you kill them. When they tend to breed too much, you don't want them, you get rid of them. If they have a color you don't like, you get rid of them. If the cow doesn't give milk, you cut its throat, and so forth and so on. So these kinds of ecology, these ideas of Malthusianism, as they're called, or neo-Malthusian, are always incompetent. But there's a real issue of ecology, which is quite far different. The best modern definition of ecology was given by a Russian scientist, Vladimir Vinadsky, who defined the terms biosphere and noosphere. We live on a planet where there are certain conditions which are created by living organisms. That is what we think of as resources generally, the oceans, the atmosphere, the forests, the mineral deposits we have accessible in from sedimentary rock and so forth. These things were all created by life. And therefore, humanity, which is comes into the picture with cognition, depends upon this living part of the planet, the so-called biosphere. we're able to improve the biosphere by use of technology. We can create fertile areas where deserts existed. We can improve, we can have forests where there were no forests. We can improve the management of water. We can improve the weather. So we should do it. So therefore, our objective in ecology, strategic question of ecology, should be we should promote those measures of infrastructure development and maintenance which are necessary to improve the conditions of life, the biosphere. Yes, we should do that. We also need to spend more on hospitals, on medical systems. We need to deal with the diseases of animals the same way we deal with human diseases, because they spread, diseases of plants. So therefore, we have to have a policy of managing the biosphere for the advantage of humanity. But the idea of ecology, of saying, let's leave nature alone, let's not tamper with nature, let's not change nature, that's a mistake. It's an unscientific and incompetent. It's the old Venetian school. The way to approach the ecology is to say, this is the biosphere. We have to improve it in the same way that a farmer improves raw land, which is unproductive, and converts it into productive land. That should be our policy.
We also have a set of questions that have to do regarding a subject that has been debated a lot here in Peru. It has to do with the interoceanic highway. The question says, Brazil is interested in building, along with Peru, a bioceanic highway in the south of Peru, in the framework of the New Bretton Woods. Do you think that this is feasible to build such a highway? And who should be in charge of the building of such work? Should it be the states or should it be done by...
Well, it's obviously it should be done by primarily by governments. The governments must control it, because the building of any such highway system, and I think a rail system is also crucial. I don't think there should be just a highway system. I think a highway system is good. But we, look, for example, you have, in this area, in Peru, you have a mountainous area. Now, what are the gradients for going up those mountains? You're not going to take a friction rail system and go up those mountains. Nor is it efficient to use trucks to take large freight up and down those mountains. The kind of system which will do that effectively is a magnetic levitation system, a substitute for rail system. If you want to get into areas of Peru, for example, which are higher, which are sparsely developed in terms of what the resources are, to get over to the other side, down toward the Amazon side, and develop that. So we do need large arteries, not just of highways, but arteries of corridors of transportation and development. Looking at what we did in the United States, for example, in the middle of the 19th century, we developed a system of transcontinental railroads, which were not just transportation systems, they were development systems. We took a nation which had two principal oceanic frontiers, the Pacific and the Atlantic. We brought the Pacific and the Atlantic together in the middle with the development of development corridors, which were initially agricultural development corridors, things like that, based on the transcontinental railway system. It is obvious when you look at the geography of South America, you look at the vast resources which are not accessible for efficient use now, for lack of development corridors, it's obvious as necessary. Even the internal Peru, it's obvious to all of us who've discussed Peru, that this is needed. To realize the economic potential of Peru, this is needed. To realize the economic potential of the hemisphere, this is needed. It's needed from the Pacific to the Atlantic. It would be, in my opinion, insane not to do it. The question is, can governments agree on how to do it? But I think the directions are needed are not really political. In choosing routes, I think the routes follow the natural geography, which indicates what the proper routes are for development corridors to connect the Atlantic with the Pacific. I think it's important. I think that this is maybe essential to accelerate the rate of economic development of South America, may, that kind of project may be something of the highest priority.
Mr. LaRouche, we have a related question related to the previous. It comes from Mr. Alexis Toledo from the International Organization of Fujimoristas. The question is the following. How do you get cooperation among governments to carry out great projects? How do you come up with standardized policies among states? The benefits of carrying out this project, these projects will be long-term. That is the question.
Well, first of all, I think we've got to find a fundamental change in the world political situation, for better or worse, coming very soon. If it comes from better, this will mean that in South America in particular, that the role of the sovereignty of the sovereign nation state will be much greater than has been in recent years. That is, the tendency toward globalization, the tendency toward denationalization, if you call it, this tendency has to be reversed. Otherwise, no economic solutions are possible. People who think that think in free trade terms, think in terms that we want the lowest price. And the lowest price is had by having competition without any subsidies or without any regulation. Well, that's not true. The key way in which you get economic growth is through long-term investments. Remember that basic investments on which an economy is based, a modern economy, is a generation. Now, this is the same generation it takes to raise a child. You have to invest from birth to up to 25 years to produce a child who is professionally qualified for work. As a 25-year investment, approximately, more or less. To develop any kind of large capital infrastructure, again, we're talking about the period of a generation or even two generations. Now, how do you do things which take two or three generations to bring to fruition, where they pay for themselves? You have to have a source of credit. Now, you can't have private credit because you're doing things on a larger scale than the present economy provides for. So borrowing money is no solution in the ordinary sense from private sources. The state must be sovereign, must use the state authority to create large volumes of credit. Take a case, case in point, up until 1982, Egypt had a large-scale project to move the populations which were congested in Cairo and Alexandria and to shift them into new cities which would be irrigated locations through large-scale water management projects. The project was going along very nicely until the United States and IMF stepped in and forbid the Egyptians to continue the project. Otherwise, it would have continued quite successfully. Now, in this project, the Egyptians actually required 5% of the total input to that project came from foreign sources. So that to do a project, for example, in Peru or in Brazil does not mean that you have to have vast external resources. The primary way to do these projects is by mobilizing internal resources using national credit, then turning to neighbors who are doing the same thing and to cooperate with them and bring in a few partners from outside of the Americas who are interested in participating and bring them in too. That way this can be done. We need grand projects. Grand projects require large-scale public credit. Large-scale public credit can only be organized by sovereign governments. When this present globalized tendency in government ends, the trends of the past 35 years end, and we are forced to go back to the sovereign nation state, when the banking systems, including the IMF, are bankrupt, when the World Bank is bankrupt, when private banks are largely bankrupt, how do you keep an economy going? You go to the government as an act of sovereignty, creates a system of public credit which maintains the essential functions of finance, including the private banks and other institutions. You then pick large-scale projects, which are national priorities, You seek large-scale projects which are also priorities with neighboring countries. You use your own people to build the projects, maybe with a handful of specialists coming in from the outside. You build a project thinking about the next generation and the generation beyond that. And when you look at South America, you look at the vast wealth, which I'm sure many of you know of, buried in South America, untapped, unutilized, great potential. When you see how thin the population of South America is, you realize that it is through, precisely through great projects of that type that you create the circumstances in which the potential of growth, not only growth in quantity, but the potential for rapid improvement in the standard of living, the demographic characteristics of populations, the welfare of the individual human being. This is the way it'll work. It takes inspiration and, of course, intelligence.
Thank you. There are two questions that we would like you to answer at once. This has to do with the international situation. The first question is, what will happen? What will happen in the world situation if a change is made from one worldism to a bipolar situation, having Russia, China, and India on one hand, I see that on one side, and on the other side, the United States. The second question, which is related to this, is the following. With regard to the role played by China today, what's the role they play in the current world financial situation?
Well, first of all, I think the idea of a bipolar world is not a very workable proposition, because a bipolar world under conditions of insanity, which threatened to break out around this terrorist incident, terrorist matters, and what's happening in the Middle East, will be a world at war. What you would have on a planetary scale, you would have something like the 1618, 1648, 30 Years' War in Europe. You would have mass slaughter. You would have a collapse of population, the extinction of entire nations, the breakup of the United States into several who knows what. So the idea that of a long bipolar world in conflict may be a nice science fiction fantasy, but it, under the present conditions, it will not happen. We will either have cooperation or we'll have general war and chaos. That's the world situation now. You can see this in the way the conflict is broken out around the Middle East conflict combined with these incidents of September 11th, the reaction to that. We're in an extremely dangerous period. The world can blow up. And the only way we get out of that is cooperation. What we have now, an example of that, is you may have noticed recent discussions between the president of Russia and the President of the United States, and the circles of the President of the United States, that there's a very interesting dialogue going on between Russia and the United States. I've been walking in that territory and know a good deal about it. Not everything, but a good deal about it. The only hope is that somehow the United States, realizing that it has a great financial crisis, realizing that the present financial system is a hopeless disaster, will turn to cooperation with Eurasia in the vital interest of the United States as well as Eurasia. Now, to build Eurasia in Eurasia, you have to include Western continental Europe with Russia, with other countries of Western Europe, and Central Europe. You have to include China. You have to include Japan. You have to include India. You have to do something about peace and development in the Central Asia region. You have to do something about Southeast Asia. So you must bring in a system of cooperation on which you can launch a large-scale development project in which countries which produce more high technology will produce it and sell it on credit to countries which, like the interior of China, which need this supply of technology, or India. And that market and the United States' opportunity to participate in that market is the best hope for the United States. So if we don't cooperate, if we can't cooperate at a time that Russia is willing to cooperate, that China is willing to cooperate, that India wishes to cooperate, that Europe wishes to cooperate, if we don't cooperate, we are insane. And therefore, if we are insane, then what we're going to have is the price of insanity, which is a new dark age. That's the way it is. If when humanity does not have the sense, when empires have not had the sense to stop being insane, they have generally destroyed themselves, like the Roman Empire and others before. And we're at the point where I realize that in Peru it's difficult to think of these things in some respects, because Peru does not have the power to walk into Washington and tell Washington what to do as such. But those of us who know, whether in Peru or elsewhere, should realize this planet cannot go in the direction it's now going. We cannot continue this system, which is about to disintegrate, nor can we have a conflict of the type which is threatened by the Middle East conflict or by the ways in which some people are trying to approach this terrorism question. We cannot have that, because this planet won't survive under those conditions. And therefore, I think that's the way you have to look at it. There is no solution except a global solution. Under those conditions, China is not a nation which, as a nation, as a national culture, thinks about the world as a whole. China thinks about its relationship to the world as a whole. It almost thinks about the world as a whole as a neighboring planet. And it has a planetary interest in China. And I'm not suggesting that the only view in China is that of the Middle Kingdom. But China does not take responsibility, cultural responsibility, for the welfare of the planet. The Chinese in Africa do excellent work. Their work in Africa is the best of any nation in terms of the charity, the honesty of what they're doing. But China doesn't think that way. There may be people in China who think that way, but China as a nation doesn't think that way. China does not think of itself as a global culture. It thinks of itself as a nation in the globe with very important interests and concerns. It is Russia, which is a Eurasian nation in its mentality. It is Western Europe, which depends upon Eurasia for its survival. It is the need for cooperation between Russia and Western Europe and China and Japan and the United States, which is the urgent question among all sane people at this time on this planet. If that idea is clear, and if we can help to make it clear in more places, that's the solution. Because in the answer to your question, the other alternatives are unspeakable. They are not acceptable, just not acceptable.